Abby Danforth is my best friend. We met back in elementary school and have been together ever since. But Eddie's leaving for summer camp and she'll be gone until August. You should come over today. We could celebrate the beginning of summer. Oh, I'd have to ask my mom. You know how she is. What did you want to do? A bunch of us are gonna go play paintball. We could leave from my place. It'll be fun. Paintball? Her idea of fun was like a punch to my stomach. Shooting games? Me? Guns? She's figuring it out, and she's angry at herself for not thinking it through beforehand. It's not her fault, though. It's not as though I wear a sign that says I killed my sister with a gun, so don't ask me to play your paintball games. No one needs to feel bad about what happened. Except me. When Sarah Cody was just 4 years old, her life was changed forever. When she picked up her father's loaded gun and accidentally shot and killed her infant sister. Now, 10 years later, Sarah suffers from deep-seated guilt that is pushing her to the point of no return. Bang by Barry Liga. My mother was still at work when I got home that day, so I went into what had been my sister's room, the nursery. I only come in here when Mom isn't home. In the movies and on TV, when someone's child dies, they almost always show the room preserved, frozen in time. But my sister's room, it's not preserved, but one has moved on and we're all stuck here in this place. The room, it serves now as storage. There are boxes and bags of things in here, most of them belonging to my father. Things my mother won't throw out. Not out of sentiment, out of spite. It made no sense to me then, and makes no sense to me now. But I try to avoid asking my mother to explain herself. I have no memories of my mom and dad together. But I don't want to remember. Memories, they go into the memory hole. That is where they belong. My therapist thought that maybe if I could remember the accident, I could move on from it. But I told him I didn't want that in my head. I didn't want to remember. My sister Lola. Time passes quickly and a little over a week into summer vacation, I've somehow managed to keep myself together. It's not time. Not yet. I'm still waiting for that yes to come at night. Waiting patiently. I have nothing but time. I have my whole life, literally. Evie's keeping in touch through Instagram and Snapchat. And it's parents' weekend, and her house is empty. And that is all I need to know. It takes forever to get to Evie's house on my bike, and using the key hidden on the hook in the garage, I slip into her house, and then I walk into her dad's study, the cabinet. It's locked. But I know he keeps the key hidden in his desk drawer. I unlock the cabinet. And then I skip over the rifles. They're too big, unnecessary. At the bottom of the case are the handguns. It's the big Magnum. This began with a Magnum. So it will end with a Magnum. I take the gun and slip it into my waistband with my shirt over the grip. Even unloaded, it's heavy. I am going to join Lola in the memory hole. It's my proper place. It's where I deserve to be. I almost don't make it. The day has gotten cooler, but the air is hot and sticky. And as I coast down one last hill, I hop off my bike and let it clatter to the ground. I'm going to do it. I'm really going to do it. I need to make things right with my father. He's a part of this. He is part of the nightmare. I approach the front door, ring the doorbell, and it opens. Hi, Dad. Sarah, I can't believe you're here. I didn't think you remembered where I lived. It's been so long. But come in and sit down. He has sad eyes. My father. I never noticed them before. Or maybe he only allows them to be sad here, in his den. If I'd have known you were coming, I'd have cleaned up a little. Why don't I take you out to dinner? I can't take it anymore. I thought maybe we could have one last conversation. But I just can't take it. I reach behind me, draw the gun, and I level it at him. His face is split by the sight at the end of the barrel. Oh, Sarah, what are you doing? He seems unafraid. He hasn't twitched since I pulled the gun out. He shakes his head. Talk to me, Sarah. If you're planning on doing it, talk to me first. Why? What made you think you deserve conversation? I'm not saying I do. It's just, don't you think we should at least say goodbye? And then, I remember the day my dad left. I was 6. I clung to him, to his leg, and a tear splashed onto the dirty brown leather of his boot. And I told him I didn't want him to go. You left us. No, that is not what I did. Don't lie to me. You went away. She died. I killed her. And you left because of me. No, Sarah, I left because of me. Why did you even have the gun? What was the stupid thing in the house in the first place? It was an accident, Sarah. You don't blame anyone for an accident. Bull! I did it! I did it! Like what I'm doing now. Don't blame the gun. You left it out. And I used it. It's our fault. That's what you think. That's what you've been thinking all this time. You think it's right to blame a boy for something she can't even understand. The gun should have never been there. I never should have had it. You don't get to cry. Not for her. You don't have the right. Maybe not. But I loved her too. I had you. I had your mother. And I had Lola. I had the best things in the world. And I had the gun. And the doorbell rang. And I go answer like a robot. I left the gun there. And it was only a salesman. I'm headed back to the gun thinking, oh no, how could I have done that? Thinking, that was close. But then, I hear it. No. So do it then! Just do it! And then my father breaks down. calls like a child who's been hurt for the first time. No reserve, no restraint, and certainly no shame. Tears explode from him, great sobs wrap his body, and his chest heaves uncontrollably. 10 years ago, I raised a gun